Welcome back to day two of our Jumpstart, Windows Azure Pack, Infrastructure as a Service. I'm Simon Perriman, and in this session, I'm joined by Joe Levy, and we're going to really focus on providing automation through the Windows Azure Pack. Let's take a quick look at where we are in our journey. Yesterday, we kind of covered the foundational components as far as understanding the benefits of Windows Azure Pack, installing and configuring it, connecting it to Virtual Machine Manager so that it can manage the fabric, and then providing self-service opportunities. Today, we're going to start by looking at automation. Then we're going to take a look at extending our solution using third-party add-ons. And finally, we're going to wrap it up by reviewing some of the different tenant experiences and covering a few other topics that we haven't got to yet today. So with that, I'll do a quick introduction again as it's the second day. I'm Simon Perriman. I've been at Microsoft about 7 years, splitting my time between engineering within Windows Server and technical evangelism. Happy to be back once again, giving you guys another jumpstart. Now, Joe, why don't you go ahead and introduce yourself?
Sure. So my name is Joe Levy. I'm a program manager on the automation and integration team at Microsoft for Cloud and Enterprise. So if it has to do with automation, I work on it.
Automation Joe, right?
Automation Joe, that's what they call me. Azure, I work on automation for Azure, automation for Windows Azure Pack, automation for the Cloud OS, automation for feeding your dog breakfast every day. If it has to do with automation, I do it. I'm a Duke University grad. Simon is also a Duke University
grad. That's right, representing the Blue Devils today.
So we're having a little small alumni event right here. It's going well so far. And here to talk to you today about SMA, and I think it should be great. They gave us a 90-minute session. All the other sessions are shorter than that, so you know what they think the most important stuff is.
Right? For sure. Well, tell us, what are we going to be covering in this session today?
Sure. So service management automation is all about what today is about. So I'm going to talk to you about what service management automation is. I'm going to talk to you about why you'd use it, how you'd use it, show you the portal for it, show you the commandlets for it, show how you can integrate from SMA into other systems and how you can integrate from other systems into SMA, show you some scenarios that really light up with the Windows Azure Pack.
Sounds good. Now, you listed a couple goals and objectives here. What's kind of the key things that we're trying to get out of this session?
Sure. So service management automation really lets you automate all the tasks that you repeatedly take in your Windows Azure Pack cloud operations, tenant management. And we're going to show you how you can integrate into your data center systems to actually, from your existing data center operations, be able to use the Windows Azure Pack in collaboration with that. We're going to show you how you can use service management automation to actually enable self-service, but at the same time apply the IT policy that your organization needs if you're an enterprise. And also, if you're an enterprise acting as a hoster or just a hoster in general, we're going to show you how to use service management automation to kind of differentiate some of your services so that you stand out to those tenants that you're providing functionality for. So let's get right into it. So this is our go-to slide that we always show when talking about service management automation. Essentially, what service management automation is a highly available, scalable, reliable workflow execution engine. So with it, you can automate all the manual, long-running, error-prone, and frequently repeated tasks that you take to manage your infrastructure, your Windows Azure Pack cloud operations, your Windows Azure Pack service administration and tenant management. And basically, all those tasks that you used to have to do manually, someone had to do manually every day to manage tenants, to manage your services, instead of having someone have to do those every day, those menial same tasks that might take a lot of time, might be error prone, and if you mess something up, you end up in a bad state and you have to go and figure out how to fix that. No, don't worry about that. Just put all those processes in the hand of service management automation and free up those DevOps folks, those service administration folks, to actually go and focus on work that adds business value instead of doing these menial but still very important tasks, repeatedly every day.
I think to kind of emphasize, one of the benefits that a lot of people don't really see with automation is that, you kind of feel that, hey, this might take my job away. But the reality is we're seeing a lot of people kind of transition their roles. And instead of spending that time doing the repetitive tasks, they're now spending their time building automation. And that's becoming their skill set. This is enabling them to do more with less and ultimately provide more value back to the company. So we really do see automation as kind of a key workload, key investment area for all of our IT pros moving forward.
Exactly. So when we talk about service management automation, there's basically a few high-level things where we say is the big features of service management automation. One of them, first one, runbook authoring. So with you can see on this left-hand side here, we have kind of a mock-up of the Windows Azure Service Administration portal. Within there, there's an automation tab where you can actually go in and from within the portal, using a web-based editor, if you want, you can author all of your automation runbooks. Runbooks are basically PowerShell workflows. You can author them straight in the same portal while you're managing your services, managing your tenants. Go in there and author the processes that you need to do in order to manage all the things you do on a day-to-day basis. Another big part, very big part, is we're built on a highly available engine. So we're backed by the PowerShell workflow engine. And what that means is we get to take advantage of all the great things about PowerShell and about PowerShell workflow. Specifically, what PowerShell workflow gives you is the ability to suspend and resume operations, do checkpoints. So if you're talking to an external system and maybe there's a network issue or something, you actually can checkpoint before that so that if whether it's the host running the runbook fails or whether it's your connection to the external host fails, the runbook will suspend and then you can come back later and resume it and then it will continue on from where it left off. So it's a much more robust execution environment than just kind of starting from the beginning every time and crossing your fingers that it works in a state where you were like half complete the first time. We also get the ability through PowerShell workflow to execute things in parallel against multiple hosts at the same time, execute some things in parallel while doing some things serially after a certain amount of parallel steps, things like that. And then if we go to this integration into other systems piece, this is also because we're built on PowerShell workflow, which is built on workflow and on PowerShell, the way you integrate into other systems from service management automation is just through PowerShell modules. So there's a ton of existing PowerShell content today, and you can take advantage of all of that in service management automation. The way you extend PowerShell is the way you extend service management automation. So you can use it. It comes out of the box with integration into your Windows Azure PAC services. It comes out of the box with integration into most of your System Center services. You can write modules or use existing modules to talk to other systems, such as Linux systems. You could write one for your specific CMDB, things like that. Basically, as long as there's a PowerShell module for it, you can integrate into it from SMA. And some of the actions we see that you actually do, we have a few listed here, there's so many. One could be integrating with your CMDB, so when something happens in Windows Azure PAC, actually sending that data over to your CMDB for tracking externally. It could be bulk importing a lot of users from another system. It could be notifying users when your plans have updates. It could be looking at your capacity and deciding, hey, I have too many tenants for the capacity I have right now, and this is how much is being used. So, you know, sending alerts off to people or automatically provisioning more capacity for you to use.
So let's go into the PowerShell workflows a little further. You know, you've kind of covered some of the differences, but I think a lot of people still really have some big conceptual hurdles with understanding. I'm using traditional PowerShell. What's different? Do I have to learn a new language?
Sure. So PowerShell workflow is, for the most part, PowerShell. There are some things that you can do in PowerShell that don't work in workflow, and some of that has to do with the fact that when you checkpoint and resume, you're basically resuming from a state in a new session. So all the data has to essentially be able to be converted into data you can store in a database and then rehydrated. And sometimes workflow is like fundamentally different from just PowerShell running in a single session because it's PowerShell running. It could be across hosts, it could be across sessions. So there are a few little quirks about it that you can go and learn. There's lots of content out there on the differences between PowerShell and PowerShell workflow. Mostly the same. PowerShell modules work exactly the same way in both. But the advantages you get out of PowerShell workflow when you're trying to automate these long-running processes that span systems are really great to do in PowerShell workflow other than PowerShell because you get parallelizability, and checkpointability, suspendability, resumability. So it really is great as kind of a robust, reliable framework.
Could you kind of emphasize a little more, what do you mean by checkpoints? You know, a lot of time we use checkpoints for virtual machines. Obviously, a checkpoint is saving a state, being able to resume it. Could you kind of just clarify kind of what's happening there with PowerShell?
So you may have a bunch of state that you've written in your process already. And then in the event of a crash, for a number of reasons, the event of a crash, you would want to make sure that if you resume, you don't have to start over from the beginning, maybe because you've done some tasks that take a long time or you've done something that isn't idempotent, so if you try to do it again, you'll actually fail. So for that reason, you want to actually add checkpoints throughout your workflows so that when you come back, when you resume from an error, you can continue on where you left off. So it really makes it a lot more reliable to run these executions.
Now, you briefly mentioned storing things in a database so you can pull it back. Could you kind of clarify a little bit more, like what type of database, where does that get stored? And if you have a distributed system, is that a single location? Is that spread across different hosts? How exactly does that work?
Yeah, so I'll get to the architecture a little more later.
Okay.
I have a whole diagram on that. Basically, there's a bunch of workers that pick up jobs. There's a bunch of web services which are used to submit the jobs. And then you have a database which stores all this information. I mean, if you look at this slide that we have up right now, we actually add some things on top of PowerShell workflow that have to do with this database system that we're talking about. So PowerShell workflow gives you these things that I've mentioned in that PowerShell workflow block right there. And then because we're a service, we're not just PowerShell workflow, we're a PowerShell workflow service, you get some additional things. In regular PowerShell, these suspends and resumes are kind of, the state is saved onto the local host running your workflow, your runbook. But in service management automation, because it's a database-backed system, all these workers save your checkpoint data into the database. So if any of the workers actually fail, another worker can come along, pick up that job where it left off, and basically grab that data from the database to keep going, despite the fact that the worker that was running it before failed. In addition, we have a kind of centralized asset store. So instead of having multiple runbooks, multiple PowerShell workflows, which all reference, you know, certain static values, you store these values in the database. And then when you need to change them, you just change them in the database, and all of your runbooks are referencing that data. So they'll go and actually pick up the correct values, versus if you're doing it outside of service management automation, you may have to go around to all of your workflows and kind of modify the same value in multiple places.
Okay.
Another thing we give you is historical analysis. So in regular PowerShell, you go and run something, you can choose to save to a file, but if you don't, it's gone, you know, if you close your console. In service management automation, we store all the jobs in the database, all the information on who started those jobs, all the information on what output came out of the jobs, what input went into the jobs, and so you're getting PowerShell as a service more than just PowerShell running on a single host due to this kind of database backness of the system. All right, here you can see we got PowerShell workflow and then centralized store, which I mentioned, highly available engine and historical analysis. That's kind of what service management automation is.
Now, when you say highly available, how exactly does it achieve that high availability? Is that through redundancy or some other mechanism?
Mm-hmm. So we have redundancy. Obviously, you can make the database highly available through SQL clustering or through SQL Server Always On. You can have one to, you know, N, however many workers you have going and picking up work, so that if one fails, the others pick up the work. You can scale that way, have more when you need more, have less when you need less. And the same thing with the web services. You just put them behind the load balancer, add more when you need more, have more than one just so you maintain high availability, things like that. So instead of running workflows on a single host, and if that host dies, you're kind of done. You're running it in a service where there's lots of hosts configured to submit jobs into the database and workers configured to kind of pick up jobs from the database.
Great. Thanks. Now, you're going to switch to the first demo now?
Yeah, I'm going to show you the service management automation portal.
Well, while you switch over, we do have our first poll of the day posted. So if everybody could please minimize their screen, if they're in full screen, go answer our poll. Because we want to kind of get some background information about our audience. The question is, what is your level of experience with PowerShell? And so we have the choices, beginner all the way through a WAP professional. And by that, we mean someone that has some experience using SMA PowerShell workflows already. So if you could please vote, that will help us somewhat guide the training to make sure that we landed at everyone's best level. Thanks. All right, back to the demo.
All right, we're back. We got the demo all set up and ready to go. So if you can see my screen right now, basically what I'm showing is the service management administration portal, the Windows Azure Pack admin portal, which I'm sure you've seen a lot yesterday in the demos. What you'll notice is down here we have this automation tab. And this is how service management automation shows up within the Windows Azure Pack portal. So if I click into that, the first thing you'll see is this dashboard. What this dashboard shows me is the history of execution of runbooks in my environment. We call an execution of a runbook a job. So if I run a runbook three times, I have three jobs that I've ran. And you can see we have charts that show over time how many jobs completed, queued, failed, suspended, are running right now. We have this quick glance section, which shows you kind of the state of your system, how many things are in there. You can see out of the box, it comes with, you know, over 3,000 activities that you can just go and use, and that's just because it uses PowerShell, and PowerShell has all these different commandlets that you can use straight out of the box to integrate into all kinds of different systems. And then we import a whole bunch of modules for Windows Azure Pack related functionality, System Center related functionality. And then you can see the latest jobs that ran actually show right here, and you can see what runbook they were, when they ran, what their status is. So you can use this screen to very easily see if there's, you know, any failed or suspended jobs, and you can say, oh, hey, something went wrong, let me go and investigate that. So other than the dashboard tab, we also have this runbooks tab, which is a very important tab. So this is where all of your runbooks show up. And you can see I have a number of runbooks in the system. You can see again in here when they were last started, what happened with the job, did it complete, did it fail, how many jobs have been run, what the authoring state is. So is someone currently working on a new version of this? It won't affect me running this in production, but can I see that, you know, someone else is updating it? And you know, we can apply freeform tags and then search by those tags. You can see the ones I'm going to demo, I have tagged as demo, and you can put any tags you want on it and search based on those tags and things like that. So what I'm going to do now is actually show you adding a runbook to our system and running it, a very simple runbook. So the usual way you would go and add a runbook is to go to New, Runbook, Quick Create, and then you'd type in a runbook name here, start from scratch. I actually have created a runbook in a file already, a PowerShell workflow, because a runbook is just a PowerShell workflow. And all I have to do is import this into my system, and I can start from this as a base. So just to show you this works, I'm actually going to run this locally first. So I'm compiling the workflow, and now in here I will type, say hello, and I will pass in my name parameter, and let's say hello to Simon. And then this will go and run this in the workflow execution environment, spit out hello Simon, which based on the code you can see is what it was supposed to do.
Nice.
So now I'm going to go and import this into my system and run it in service management automation. All right, so to do that, runbook import. And I just select that file, which is up a couple directories. Here we go. And just like that, I have imported the Say Hello runbook into my environment. So now if I go and I searched for this runbook, I should be able to find it. There it is. So now we're within a runbook. So you have the same dashboard tab, same quick glance, same jobs, but now it's all specific to this runbook. So if you wanted to drill down into a runbook and see all these things, this is how you would do that. You just click on into it. I can go to the author tab to actually see the PowerShell for my runbook. We have published and draft version of a runbook. So draft is when you're working on it and you're, you know, not ready to commit it to production as ready to run. And then once you have, you know, tested it in our authoring pane, so here you can see our authoring pane. When you've kind of done testing it and saving it and done working on it, you can hit publish and then it'll be ready to, you're certifying it as ready to run in production. So you can see my code is in here. I know that this happens to work, so I'm going to go straight to publishing mode. Some other things you can do in here is any runbooks or settings in your system, if you want to actually insert code for them, you can actually just go insert and then grab the thing you want to insert. So I'm clicking on a runbook, and it'll go and actually insert the code for me. I don't need that for this runbook, so I'm going to remove that. And so I will go and publish this, and let's run it in service management automation and see what happens.
Now, just a quick question here. It looks like we're in the administrative view, right?
Mm-hmm.
If I want to use SMA as a tenant, do I have that ability? Is it exposed to me, or is this purely in the admin portal?
So right now, this is an admin-only service. Tenants cannot directly run runbooks, but one thing I'll show you later is the ability to actually go and hook up a tenant-based action, whether it's creating a VM, signing up, things like that, to a runbook, so that on their behalf you can go and run a runbook to do something based on their signup.
Great, thanks for clarifying.
Sure. So now I have it in published state. If I go back out to my runbooks list, and I find my Say Hello runbook again, you will be able to see that it's now in published state, and so I can start it right here. When I hit start, again, because I had that parameter for name in this Say Hello runbook, again, it pops up asking me for the name. This time it's in a GUI rather than in a typing it as in a PowerShell console. So this time I'll say hello to Joe. I'll hit go. It's starting the runbook up. I could click here to see the job. But another way to get to the job, you click into the runbook, and then you can actually go to the jobs tab, and this will show you all jobs that have ran, are running for the system. So you can see the runbook is starting. I'll click into that. You can see this shows you all kinds of great data. It shows you who started it, when it started, when the last update was, what the state is, what the input parameters were for this runbook, and when the output is kind of produced, when this finishes, you'll see that appear here. You can see our runbook status is now completed, and it correctly spit out Hello Joe, which is great.
We had one question that came in wondering, can we see information about checkpoints through this dashboard view?
So not directly. Within your runbook, you would add the checkpoint dash workflow activity to actually cite a checkpoint. And then when a runbook has kind of gotten into an exception state, it would show as in suspended state. Right. And then the way you would continue from that checkpoint is just to hit resume.
Okay, thanks for clarifying.
Sure. So other thing I can see in here, if I click into history, there's not much here because this is a very simple runbook, but if I had lots of output logging, verbose logging, debug logging, progress logging, that would all show up in here. If you know it was too long to show in one line, I could hit view details to show it all within here. And another cool thing that I can do is actually, if this is a job that ran in the past, maybe against a different earlier version of this runbook, if I click on that view source, I can actually see the exact runbook definition that ran for this job, even if it has since changed for kind of future jobs. And the way you actually go and turn on that more verbose logging for your runbook is in the configure tab for a runbook. Here you can do things like, you know, update description and tags. You can also turn on that more verbose logging if you kind of need it to troubleshoot or you just want to be able to see more deeply what's going on in the system. All right. And now we'll go to the assets tab, which is our last tab. So assets are essentially global pieces of information in your system that are referenced by runbooks to be used. The different types of assets are connection, credential, certificate, schedule, module, and variable. And so I know that's a lot of information to consume. Basically, a connection is a grouped set of data that is used to connect to an external system. So if I go to add setting and go to add connection, I basically have these set of connection types that I can choose from. So let's say I want to connect into Orchestrator. So I'll click on Orchestrator service as my connection type. I'll name it whatever I want. And then this actually basically has a schema of what the fields required to connect into Orchestrator are, so I can go and fill this out with the right password, the right server of where Orchestrator is, whether to use HTTPS, you know, things like that. And this will differ based on the service you're connecting to, so everything has a unique connection type to define those properties.
Now, if I wanted to connect to Virtual Machine Manager, could I connect to it directly, or do I still need the SPF component running? So basically, am I going Windows Azure Pack to SPF to VMM, or can I go directly from Windows Azure Pack SMA to VMM if I call the VMM commandlets?
Yeah, you can. We have the Virtual Machine Manager module in here. We have the Virtual Machine Manager connection type in here, so you can go and actually connect straight into VMM. That works better for your scenarios than connecting through SPF.
Okay, so no dependency on that, but optional. You can use that.
Yeah, whatever works for you. So other than connections, we also have credentials. For credentials, we have a certificate, in which case you would upload a certificate that you have on your local system. We also have PowerShell credentials, which is essentially a username and password combination that I would type in. And encrypted fields of a connection, encrypted variables, and encrypted fields of a credential, PowerShell asset credential, are actually stored securely in our database. So you don't have to worry about, are they secure? You don't have to worry about, how do I reference them in my runbooks and keep it secure? It's just, you create them through this, you update them through here, and then you, within your runbook, reference them, and I'll show you doing that later. So that covers connections, certificates, and credentials. I'll talk a little bit more about schedules later and modules later, and I can quickly show you variables. A variable is basically a free-form piece of information that you reference in multiple runbooks. So I can define what type I want it to be, and I can define the value, and then I can actually set it as encrypted if I want the value to not show up in the portal, if I want it to be stored securely in the database, you know, things like that.
Now this database you're referencing, is this all in the WAP database?
So this is a separate database that service management automation uses. Whether it's the same SQL Server as WAP is kind of up to you. I think there are some best practices out there on when to use the same database for these different services and when not to. But yeah, a specific database for service management automation is where all this data is saved to and retrieved from.
Great.
And now I think that concludes our demo, so I'm going to switch back to our deck.
All right. Well, while we switch back, we did get most of the poll results in, so thank you for voting. It looks like about a third of you say you're a beginner, a third of you say you're intermediate, and then we kind of narrow down from there. So it actually looks like we've kind of targeted this right. There are a lot of people that are brand new to PowerShell, brand new to Service Manager automation. Mm-hmm. So we're going to make sure we take you through everything and get you covered end to end.
Sure. Great.
What's next?
So next, I'm just going to do a quick recap of what I showed you already, talking about the different features of SMA, and then we'll go on to some more advanced things. So what I showed you, runbook authoring. So as you can see, as I showed, you can go and actually author runbooks straight in this portal. If you don't want to do that, you can, of course, write them in the ISE and import them, which I also showed. The ability to manage assets, whether it's importing modules or creating kind of settings that are referenced for multiple runbooks and schedules, which I'll show a little bit later. The ability to browse and see what you can use in your runbooks and quickly insert the kind of stub for that operation into your runbook so that you don't have to go and kind of guess what can I use in here. The ability to go and test, I'll show a bit later, but you saw there was that test button, which will actually inline on your authoring page, run that test, and you'll be able to continue authoring while also seeing the output in that test window below. And then the ability to go and publish once you've tested enough that you're certifying it and saying, okay, this is ready to run in production, someone else can go and start it and everything will be fine. Managing runbooks and jobs. So I showed you the dashboard view where you can see all up what's happening in your system, if there's any errors occurring. I showed you the runbooks view where you can filter based on the runbooks you want to see a lot of status information about them. And the jobs view where you can see the history of all jobs that have executed for a runbook and actually kind of dig in and actually see what input was it given, what output did it produce, things like that. And the ability to actually stop, suspend, or resume it from there. If it was running, you can stop it. If it had suspended due to an issue, you can stop it or actually resume it to have it continue running when you fix the issue that caused it to fail, things like that. And then managing the assets and administration. I showed you, again, talking about assets. And then I'll show you a little bit later. I didn't show you this yet, but administration through PowerShell and some things you can do, some more things you can do actually only through PowerShell that we consider one-off actions as you wouldn't take very much, but all this great management of your automation can be done through the portal, can be done through the commandlets. So one thing I didn't cover is how you actually install this great functionality. So as part of the orchestrator install media, there's this, there's at the right, bottom right of the installer, does this have zoom it? Can't zoom it here. But if you go to the install media for Orchestrator and you look at the bottom left under Service Management Automation, that's so you can install the web service, the worker, and the PowerShell module. So the web service basically is how you submit information to the database. It has authorization and access authentication and authorization. So you can authenticate through basic auth or Windows auth. You have an authorization group that's used to say, okay, who's actually allowed to access the web service, and then it goes and submits that data to the database, and it uses HTTPS with a self-signed cert by default. Then the workers actually go and pick up that information from the database for jobs to run and actually send information back to the database for checkpoint data, or maybe it's to grab assets or to grab job out, to send job output data back to the database, things like that. And then we have two different clients that we use to talk to SMA, but I'll show more later. You can build whatever client you want to talk into SMA to integrate into it. We have the PowerShell module, which lets you through commandlets actually manage SMA. And then we have the service admin portal, which I showed you already. So here's a little bit on the architecture of service management automation. So I kind of talked about this already. You can see we have, you know, 1 to N web services, 1, 2, 3, 4, however many you want to have would be behind a load balancer. Your clients, whether it's a service admin portal or the PowerShell module, talk to that web service to actually submit data and store it in the database. And then your workers actually go and consistently pull that database to figure out, is there any jobs for me to pick up? Should I persist some checkpoint data back? Did any output get produced by my jobs that I should persist back to the database? Things like that. All right, now let's go straight into talking about how to integrate into SMA. So I talked about how to run a regular runbook, but what are the different ways that you can integrate SMA into your existing data center operations or custom systems that you want to use with the Windows Azure Pack in general? And there's a couple ways to do that. You can integrate from SMA using PowerShell modules, which we kind of talked a little bit about already, but I'll cover some more. And then you can integrate into SMA from other systems using our web service. Our web service is built on OData, so you can very easily build a client that can talk to the web service, or you can use our PowerShell commandlets, whether by hand in the console or by having an application call them, you know, whatever works best for you. But we have an open, easy-to-use, REST-based OData web service that makes it very easy to integrate into SMA and start runbooks, create assets, things like that. So let's talk first about how do you from SMA integrate into other systems. And the great thing here is because we're built on the PowerShell engine, as long as you can integrate into, as long as you can extend PowerShell, you can extend SMA. So PowerShell modules that you use to extend PowerShell, you can import them and use them to extend SMA to talk to those same other systems. If there's not a PowerShell module for what you need to write, to what you need to integrate into, you can write your own in PowerShell script or in C#. But the thing is, there's so many PowerShell modules and such a great community around PowerShell out there today that there really are solutions built for a lot of external systems already. But obviously, if you built your own custom systems, then you would go and write your own PowerShell module to integrate into them.
Now, what are some of the community systems that are, or community sites that are out there, right? We have like CodePlex. Is that a good example? Are there others that you could recommend for people to go find these? Mm-hmm.
So Script Center seems to be the one that stores the most PowerShell modules. Coming in PowerShell v5, there's actually going to be a NuGet PowerShell gallery where they want everyone to go and store these PowerShell modules, and there'll actually be commandlets on your local system to go and actually grab things from the gallery. So that'll make it very easy to search what's in the gallery, go and grab what's in the gallery, and then all you have to do is import it straight into service management automation.
Great.
So, and then if we're talking about integrating from other systems into SMA, that's done through the web service. So the web service is built on OData, so it makes it very easy to for computers to discover what the functionality is and how can I integrate into it. You basically just point it at one URL for your web service, and then it gets, by looking at that URL, you get all this, not very human-readable, but machine-readable information. And then applications that understand OData can go and grab and create a client based on that. Again, we do authentication through Windows Auth and Basic Auth, whatever works better for you. And then the way you control authorization on who is allowed to access the service is done through a local group on each web service called the SMA Admin Group. So you would add groups to that, you would add local users, system domain users to that to say that they had access to the service. And then built on top of our web service, one client that we have is the PowerShell module, which makes it very easy to, from the PowerShell console or through PowerShell, integrate into service management automation. We have 40 commandlets today. We have commandlets to do basically everything you can do from the service management automation portal in the Windows Azure Pack portal, and also some commandlets for more one-off administration tasks, like changing the runbook workers that are configured to pick up jobs, adding a license key in the event that you're eval and you want to go off of eval because you like SMA so much, and changing the purge date on like how old jobs have to be before you want to remove them from your system, things like that. So these more one-off administration tasks. Another great thing about this is it actually comes out of the box in service management automation. So from service management automation, you can actually automate service management automation itself. So another SMA system or even that SMA system you can automate through service management automation. So you kind of have this inception thing going on where not only can I manage other systems, I can manage myself, which is pretty cool.
So nested SMA automation, essentially.
Right.
And you can also do nested runbooks, nested workflows as well.
Right,
I'll
show
where
that
you can
later.
Call another. Okay, great.
Mm-hmm. You can call them synchronously as child runbooks invoked inline, straight in your PowerShell code, just like you would call a function. And you can also, through the commandlets, actually call them asynchronously, kick off a job. And then if you want to, you can wait by checking the job status, or you can just kick it off and go do something else, whatever works better for you.
Now, we actually did have one more question that came in here. So the question is, can we actually kick off a workflow using the SPF module, or does it explicitly have to use the SMA one?
So one thing I'll show later is the ability to, what I think the question is asking is, based on actions taken in SPF or tenant actions taken, can we go and actually kick off Runbooks. And the answer is yes, and I'll show that later. There's a whole list of objects from SPF and a whole list of actions that are taken on them, and then you can set up a runbook to actually run when those actions are taken. And the runbook will be passed in a whole bunch of information about the action and who did it and what it was done on, so that you have enough information to go and actually do whatever you need to do to actually fulfill your on this SPF event, go and do this custom action thing. So back at the deck, one other piece of integration I want to talk about, if we can get the deck, thank you, is SMA and Orchestrator. So a lot of people today are like, okay, you know, there's Orchestrator for automation, there's SMA for automation, SMA comes within the Orchestrator install media, when do I use one versus the other? And the way we think about it is, continue to use Orchestrator to manage your data center operations for your established data center. It has integration into SharePoint off the bat, it has integration into Service Manager off the bat. But use service management automation to integrate into your Windows Azure Pack, your Cloud OS services, because it has integration into SPF, into all kinds of Windows Azure Pack services. Another thing is they can actually, we have a PowerShell module for Orchestrator that ships in SMA, and we have a PowerShell module for SMA that I talked about already that you can use in Orchestrator. So it's actually very easy to call both solutions from the other solution, Orchestrator from SMA, SMA from Orchestrator.
Now, the integration pack you're referring to, is that the REST integration pack within Orchestrator that allows you to trigger SPF, or is that something actually different?
So you can use the REST one.
Okay.
There's also the PowerShell module. So Orchestrator is able to run PowerShell. So you can use the invoke PowerShell script, I think it's called, and you'd basically just give Orchestrator access to that PowerShell module, and through there you could actually say, go and use the SMA commandlets to go and start a runbook, get some job output, you know, whatever you need to do.
And now there shouldn't be any actual limitations on triggering the things through SMA. And I guess what I mean by that is you could take parameters through Orchestrator, you know, take those different parameters, send through the data bus, put them into that PowerShell commandlet, that gets then passed into SMA and right. Can continue to be used. So you could essentially continue to pass those parameters through all the way down to SMA.
Yes, exactly, exactly. Okay. So those processes can continue from Orchestrator into SMA, passing the same data, and again, from SMA into Orchestrator, passing the data if you need to do it that way as well.
Excellent.
All right, and so with that, I'm going to go into another demo where I talk about all these different ways of integrating between one system and another.
Okay, so as we switch over here, I think that answered kind of the key questions that are open. So, please go ahead.
All right, let me pull up that environment. Okay, here we are. Demo is ready, locked, and good to go. Okay, so the first thing I want to show is integrating from SMA into another system. So in this example, I have a PowerShell module that I've created called SSH, which actually lets me, through PowerShell or through SMA, because PowerShell modules work in both, actually go and actually connect to a system through SSH. So what this lets me do is actually go and manage Linux systems, for example, from PowerShell, from SMA. So I'm not going to go into detail on the code in here, but you can say I have this SSH module. Within it, I have a commandlet called invoke SSH command. And then if I go back into my portal, here it is, I can actually go and import that module to make it usable in my system, to make using connecting into SSH usable in my system. So here it is. So the way you do that is you zip up a PowerShell module and you just go to import module and you import it, and it'll add it into the system, and then it'll go and actually interrogate that module and figure out all the commandlets that are in there to give you kind of design time access to them and knowing what's in the system. So it'll go and extract those activities. We use some runbooks internally to actually go and do this. So we're actually relying on runbooks to do some system functionality, which shows you how reliable and dependable the SMA system is. So now what I can do, I can go to assets, and I'd actually previously imported this already, so it should actually, SSH is what I want. So if I go in here, you can see my SSH module is there. If I click into that, I can actually see the one commandlet that I've written for this module is exposed in here. I have a nice description for it. And another thing you'll see is this module, I actually added the one custom file that you can add on top of a PowerShell module to kind of make it a true integration module for SMA, which is the connection file. And that file lets me define the fields that I consider important to connect into whatever this module is for. So in this case, it's SSH. So when I go to add connection, I can actually pick SSH as the connection type. Let me just give this a name. And you can see I've decided that the important fields for a connection to have are an optional port, a username, the host name to connect to, and a password. And again, password is obviously stored securely, so it will be secure in the database. Port is optional, so if I don't enter it, it'll be okay. But you know, you can see username and computer name are needed, so it makes me do that before continuing. I've actually already created a connection to my Linux host, which I will click into here and show you. So you can actually click into assets just like you can click into runbooks and see data on them. So I have a description, I have the password stored securely in here, the computer name, and the username to use. So now what I'll do is I'll actually go and run a runbook that'll connect into it. So I go to my runbooks tab. Let's find that runbook that will let me do that. List Linux commands, kind of a tongue twister. So I click in here, I'll click over to author, and I'll show you this runbook. So you can see it's a very simple runbook. This is actually utilizing a connection asset. And you can see the way we do that is using this commandlet, this activity, to go and grab the connection named joeubuntu123, which I just showed you, stored in this connection variable. And then I'm calling that commandlet and just passing that connection straight in. Depending on kind of their support for connection types, some commandlets you may have to pass the fields in one by one, but this module that I've written actually lets you pass the connection object straight in, and internally it figures out what fields to map to, you know, the SSH client. And then I'm actually also passing in a script block. So in this case, what I'm doing is I'm actually going to the bin directory on my Linux host. Let me just start this so we don't have to wait for it to finish running. So I started it with test, and what test will actually do is make it show up in this output pane in line, so that I can continue to work while I actually see the output if I want, just like the PowerShell ISE. You don't have to switch pages to do your testing and authoring. So anyway, what this will do is it'll go to the bin directory and list out everything. This is a very simple example. You could do much more complicated things, start Linux services, use bash variables within here if you want. But all I'm doing is listing out all of the different commands that you can use on a Linux host from whatever directory you're in, because they're all stored in bin if they're kind of globally available. So you can see I have the status of running here. The job has been picked up and is running. And hopefully soon it should produce some output for us. Let's see.
Now, while this is running, we did have another question that came in about auditing. Mm-hmm. So specifically, as the administrator, can I keep track of who's been triggering these workflows, who's made changes? Basically, is there any type of audit trail?
Yeah, so one thing I showed on the jobs page is you actually can see who started a runbook. That's kind of the extent of our auditing right now. So runbooks, you can see who started them. We don't have such strong auditing that you can see, oh, who changed the value of this asset, who created this asset, things like that. SMA is a V1 product, so we're constantly improving it. We just put out what our starting vision was for it, and auditing is definitely a big ask we get.
So can I say that this is an opportunity for our audience out there to give feedback through the chat as well?
You can say that.
Okay, great. So if you guys want to see more things out of SMA, certainly include it in the chat, as we do have our engineering team answering questions here as well. So a great opportunity for you guys to help influence the product as well.
Right, right. So if we can go back to our demo, you can see now I have the status completed, and the job is completed, and it has correctly, ignore this DF, I guess I forgot to remove that in my testing, but you can see the rest of these are valid Linux commands that have all popped out, and it actually has gone out to my Linux host using that commandlet from that module, that SSH module, and actually list all of the cool things I can do in there, like bunzip2. Not sure what bunzip2 does, but if I wanted to, I could do that, which is great. And another way to figure that out is I could actually put in man bunzip2. It might be bunzip2, that probably makes more sense. Mm-hmm. And you would go and it would actually show the manual again that would come through in our console. So this is just one example of integrating into an external system. In this case, a Linux host. You could do this to target your CMDB, Azure, anything you can dream up that can be kind of written as a PowerShell module to extend into it, you can do within SMA.
Now, we did have another question about Linux here. Mm-hmm. So the question is, I'm running on a Windows system using PowerShell. If I want to then go and use Linux-specific commands, do I have that ability? Basically, how do I initiate through SMA and then go ahead and call various Linux commands?
You definitely have that ability. This is just an example module I've built. It's not exactly the most robust thing. Like, for example, it doesn't have support for certs right now. It's just username and password based. But I mean, I can put whatever I want in here, and actually it can go and run that on one Linux host. I could put this in a for loop and pass in an array of computers, and it could run them on all those Linux hosts. I can use the results of my Linux command within the rest of my runbook. As you can see, right now all it does is spit it out to the output screen.
But could you then pass that data? Because that's actually a second question that we've got here as well.
So if I assign this to out like so, then all of this data, right now I think it's passed as a string back, but it might be a string array and you could, you know, parse each line. But you can basically get that output stored in a variable and use it further down. In the same way, if I had another variable up here, you know, dollar A equals something. That's not an equal sign. I'm not used to this keyboard. I could, you know, similarly use dollar A in here, and when it runs, it would actually take the value of A, and that would be passed in here. So in this case, it would do LSFG. So I really can integrate into the systems, get the data back from the systems, use it in the rest of my process, and also pass information from my earlier steps in the runbook in the process into the system that I'm integrating into. Cool. So that is one side of integrating into SMA. That's integrating from SMA into an external system, but as I talked about, there's also the web service and the PowerShell commandlets to integrate into SMA. So the next thing I'm going to show is using the OData web service to actually write a custom application that will go and use the web service to integrate. So you can see I have Visual Studio open here, and one great thing about Visual Studio is it has direct support for OData. So I can actually go to Service References, hit Add Service Reference, and then I can point it at my my web service for my SMA server, hit go. Because it's using a self-signed cert, it's popping this up. And you can see it discovered an API up there, and it discovered all these different resources for that API. I could then hit OK, and it would actually add that. It would generate a client library that I could use from the rest of my code here. So I already have that done, so I'm going to hit cancel and just actually show you that by clicking into my service reference to SMA. You can see it has all these resource types listed here that are in the system, connection types, which I talked about, connections, jobs. You can see it has all these different methods that it's generated on that. I didn't have to go and do any work. All I did was point it at Service Management Automation Web Service, and because this understands OData, it went in and generated a client library for me. So now what I've done is actually write a little tiny application that'll actually go and talk to my web service and start a runbook. So the first thing I do is I give it my web service. I'm giving it the runbook to actually call get numbers. So if I go back to my portal and actually show you, get numbers, yeah, that's fine. Get numbers is a runbook that's in my system. Click into that. And you can see I have, basically, it takes in the parameters low and high, and then it goes and it actually goes through between low and high, and it just spits out the numbers in between them. Very simple example, but illustrates the point. So I'm calling that runbook, and then what I'm doing down here is I'm checking that the runbook is in there, and then I'm actually going, I'm adding values for the runbook params. So I'm setting low to 3, and I'm setting high to 10. Let's just do 4 for this, just to show some difference. And then the next thing I do is I actually go and start the job, and then I continually, you can see right here, I continually check whether the job is completed. If the job hasn't completed or failed, then I just keep waiting. Once the job has completed or failed, I actually go and I spit out the output into this app I've written. And you can see I do that down here. Job stream text. So now I'll go and actually start this up, and it'll start that get numbers runbook through the web service and actually go and do this.
Now, I think some of our IT pros out there may be a little afraid by the whole Visual Studio writing code thing. Do you have any recommendations for people to kind of ramp up with a little bit of the basics? You know, how do I just kind of get started with this?
With Visual Studio?
Yeah.
You know, I'm not a master of Visual Studio myself. I'm actually also, similarly, I do everything in PowerShell or in the PowerShell ISC. Visual Studio is just kind of one example of how you could do this. I'm going to show you the next thing is doing the exact same thing from PowerShell. In terms of resources for Visual Studio, I think there are a whole bunch of great resources.
It's going to be the Microsoft Virtual Academy again. Yeah, so we actually do have a variety of courses on Microsoft Virtual Academy. I guess I was wondering, you know, back in college, you probably used Eclipse, right?
I did.
Well, how did you get started with Visual Studio? Just because a lot of our IT pros have just never touched Visual Studio. Did you just kind of get made to learn it, forced into it?
For this demo, I decided I wanted to try it from something other than PowerShell, and my manager had experience calling SMA. So I was like, okay, I'm going to open up this solution in Visual Studio, see what it does, see how it works, play around with it, look on Microsoft Virtual Academy to fill in all the pieces that
nice
I don't
plug,
know.
I like it.
Anyway, so you can see it detected the parameters, it started the job. The job status was activating at first, then it went to completed, and then it actually spit out the numbers between 4 and 10 because those were the parameters I passed in. And similarly, if I now go back to my portal and I go to jobs for this runbook, you'll see there's a new job that was started right around the same time as now. And if I click in, you can see my parameter values that I passed were passed in there, and it correctly spit out 4 to 10 right there. All right, so that is integrating from Visual Studio through the web service. Now let's quickly cover using the PowerShell commandlets to integrate into SMA. So the way I'm going to do that is I've written this other runbook called Say Many Hellos, which essentially all it does is it takes in one message and an array of names, and it goes and calls that Say Hello runbook that I showed at the beginning on every name. So it'll spit out Hello Simon, Hello Joe, and it'll go through all the names just by calling this runbook, which I've referenced from within this new runbook. So just like you can reference functions within functions, you can reference runbooks within runbooks, workflows within workflows. And then it'll spit out my message. So what I'm going to do is actually, using the commandlets, import this, publish it, start it, show you the output. And rather than me typing a lot, I've actually got a little cheat sheet of the commands right here that I'm going to go and run. So the first thing I'm going to do is actually import that runbook. So I've hit import, and I've assigned the output of that import operation to $RB. If I spit that out, you can see a runbook was actually imported. If I go into my SMA portal, and I now search for Say Many Hellos, it'll be in there. Come on, portal. There we go. So if I search for Say, you'll see that not only is my Say Hello runbook in there, but my Say Many Hellos runbook is now in there. But it's in state new. So we want to put it in state publish so that we can call it in production. So the way I do that is I just call this publish SMA runbook commandlet, pass in the runbook ID from that output of import. So I'll run that. Now it's in publish state. And now I can actually go and start it. So you can see what I have here is I have this PowerShell object I've created that has a message key with a value of hi MVA folks, and has an array of names key with a value of Joe, Anshuman, Shri, Vaibhava, Bradley, John, and Simon. So these are all your presenters over the today and yesterday. And so hopefully they'll be very happy that I'm being very nice to them and saying hello. So now let's go and actually start that runbook using the start SMA runbook command. So I've started that up, and I've assigned the output to job ID. So if I actually type in job ID, you can see I have a ID for that job. If I go back into my portal, and I go to Say Many Hellos, and I go to jobs, you can see I have a job in here that's starting up. So now if I go back to my commandlets, we also have commandlets to inspect a job and, you know, see its current status. Whoops. So let's do that and see what state it's in. So you can see it's still activating. Let's do this a few more times, see if it starts up. Appears we have to wait a sec. But you can see we have all this great information stored in the commandlets as well. You know, any errors that came out, warnings that came out, exceptions, when it was started, the current status, when it was created, all this great stuff. So the job is now in completed state, which means now if I use the get SMA job output commandlet, I can programmatically get all the output. So I'll go and I'll do that. And you can see it correctly spit out my, not sure what this error is, but it correctly spit out all the correct data. It said hello to everyone in that array, and then it said my message, which was hi MVA folks. And then similarly, again, because this is just using the web service, all this stuff shows up in here as well. I can see my parameters that I passed in, and I can see the output. All right, and with that, this demo is also completed, so I'll go back to my deck.
Great. Now, while you're switching over, I would like to ask everybody to vote for our second poll, which has just started. And in this second one, we're asking you, how do you manage automation? Do you just have a bunch of scripts that are in a share that everyone can use? Do you use System Center Orchestrator? Do you use PowerShell, some other third-party solution, or do you just not centrally manage them and have them all just kind of running isolated on each server? So please share that feedback with us in the poll window now. Back to you, Joe.
All right. So next thing we're going to talk about, now that we covered how to integrate SMA into your existing data center operations or other systems other than the Windows Azure Pack, let's talk about some more specific scenarios other than just integrating that you might want to do and utilize SMA for. So the first one is if you're an enterprise, you probably have a lot of compliance that you need to apply, a lot of policies that you want to apply to anything that the people in your organization do. At the same time, since you're using Windows Azure Pack, there's probably a good chance you want to give them the ability to do self-service. And so how do you kind of live in a world where I want to provide self-service, but I also want to have compliance? You know, how can I make that easy for my users? And a good way to do that is with SMA. So if the next demo I'm going to show you is, we're actually going to go straight into the demo on this one, is enforcing compliance. And basically what I'll show is a self-service action, which we then take, we apply compliance to so that even though users go and do what they need to do, we can still do the tasks we need to do to kind of obey our organization's rules.
Great. So while you flip over, I've had a couple of questions that are kind of come in saying, can you integrate SMA with this? Can you integrate SMA with this? Things such as BizTalk server. Well, the answer to this is generally yes, so long as they have a programmatic interface that we call such as PowerShell. Now remember, one of the magic things behind Orchestrator SMA is that we do really try to make it extensible. So let's take BizTalk server as an example. They have several different PowerShell modules for each of their different components. We certainly can trigger them through SMA simply by going and invoking that PowerShell module. So generally, yes, the whole kind of design goals for all of these automation systems, again, making it extensible, whether that's SSH, SOAP, REST, APIs, PowerShell, scripts, whatever you want, our goal is to integrate. And if you genuinely find something that can't integrate and it has APIs, we really want to know about it because we are trying to continue to make this the most integrated system available.
Mm-hmm. Our goal is to, you know, whether we write them or someone in the community writes them, you know, get some content out that kind of connects into that system. And because it's PowerShell, there's a huge PowerShell community today. So if you want to integrate into BizTalk, and anyone wants to do that from PowerShell, there's probably a PowerShell module around that today. And then you can go and import that into SMA and boom, you're ready to go. That easy, hopefully. So now we got our back to the demo. So I'm in the service administration portal. And you can see I have a number of plans set up. Let's pretend I'm in enterprise for now. So let's say one plan I have, it's called Test Cloud, is so that anyone can go and just randomly spin up a VM, do whatever workload they want to do on it. And I don't want to block them on doing that. I want them to very easily let them go and do that. But at the same time, I don't want these tons of VMs that aren't being used anymore kind of stopping new people from doing the same thing because I'm running out of capacity or something. So I want to have something hooked up where, okay, you can go and create a VM, but you know, after X days, I'm going to email you and say, hey, this VM is going to get cleaned up. And then if you don't request an extension, maybe X days later, I'm going to go and remove that VM. And in this way, I would comply with some policies that my organization has created to say, hey, you know, don't keep all these old resources around all the time. Let's do some cleanup so that we don't get bogged down with old stuff. So what I'm going to do, I have this test cloud plan, which I'm basically, let's say my policy is anything that goes in this test cloud gets cleaned up after a certain amount of days. So if I go over to my tenant portal, you probably recognize this from yesterday, I'm in here, I'm subscribed to my test cloud plan. So that means I can go and create virtual machines on that test cloud. I've actually gone and done that already. JoeTest123 I created yesterday. And it's an example of, hey, I wanted to go run some quick tests. I needed another machine, so I just booted up a virtual machine on this cloud. Now at the same time, how do we go and actually make sure that those are cleaned up over time? We could say, hey, user, you're supposed to go and clean it up and then hope they do. Or we could take matters into our own hands and write a runbook that'll run and actually go and see how old a resource is and go clean it up if it's too old. And that's what we're going to do in this case. So if I go over to runbooks, I've actually created a runbook. What do you know to do this exact thing? So I called it remove old VMs. So let's go and search for that. Remove old VMs.
Now, I see you have a couple dozen in there. Do you have any limit on the number of runbooks that SMA can centrally manage?
It's a good question. No, I don't think we have a limit today. I mean, obviously, your database size limit is going to limit the amount of, in general, data you can store. But there's no limits on how many runbooks you can put in there. And we expect you to have a ton, because the whole point of runbooks is to create modular functionality that you can plug from other runbooks, kind of like how I showed say many hellos calling say hello.
I think that's a really good point. I mean, I think that's a general best practice that we encourage our people to use, regardless of whether they use an SMA, orchestrator, anything like that, is that modularity, right? Instead of writing a massive workflow, a massive runbook, break it down into the discrete parts so that, you, as you said, you can reuse them. So great tip there.
Right. Anything that you think is reusable, create a runbook that just does that and call it from your bit larger process runbooks to do.
Great.
So here we are at my remove old VMs runbook, and you can see it takes in a plan name to do things on. Days old to remove is how old a VM should be for me to go and remove it, and days old to notify, which is a number, hopefully less than remove, at which point you would say, hey, we're going to go and clean up your VM soon, and you send an email to them to say that so that they're aware they either need to request an extension, back up that data, or, you know, do nothing if they're completely fine with, oh, you know, I'm not using it anymore, you can go and kill it. So within here, I utilize, you know, a good deal. This is like a real runbook that I'm doing real things in. So I'm grabbing a connection to VMM. We got that question before, can you connect straight to VMM? I'm doing that in this runbook. And then I'm actually, I have a credential asset for this orchestrator at outlook.com email account. And this is the account that I send my emails from when I want to say, hey, your VM is going to get cleaned up soon. And then I'm grabbing the credentials for that account from this credential asset that I've created, which I'm using the get automation PS credential activity to go and grab. And then what I do is I basically use the virtual machine manager module to get all of my VMs that are in that plan, in this test cloud plan. And then based on looking at how old they are, I decide, are they a VM to notify on? Are they a VM to remove? And then I actually go, I spit out some data just to the job log so I can see. And then I actually go, and for each of those VMs to notify on, I actually send an email to that, to the owner. And you can see the owner is the VM owner identifier, which in my case will be joelevy123@outlook.com. And then I send that email. And then for VMs that are so old that I should be removing them, I just go and actually call the PowerShell commandlet in the virtual machine manager module to go and remove those VMs. So now what I'll do is I'll actually run this. So I've published it already, so I'll go start it. So for plan name, I'm going to do, just to make sure I do it right, it is called Test Cloud. So I want to apply this policy to only the Test Cloud. Days old to remove, I don't actually want to go and remove anything for this demo, so I'm going to say 6. But what I do want to do is actually show the notification part. So I'm actually, it may be 1, it may be 0, I'm not exactly sure at what time I created the VM. So just for this demo, I'm going to say 0 just to force it to notify me on that one VM that I've created. And then I can go and start this up. You can see it's starting the runbook, I can go to view job. And as you can see, got a little bit of auditing there, you can see I started it. You can see the parameters that were passed in, and then it is starting up now. And what you'll essentially see is over here I have my Outlook.com inbox for joelevy123@outlook.com, which is the same tenant as created this VM. And what it'll go and do, and actually here are some old emails, but it'll send me a new one saying, hey, your VM is at an age where we're going to get rid of it soon, so here's an email to say, hey, we're going to get rid of it soon, you know, get ready, do what you need to do. And so let's see where we're at.
Now, you might be in trouble. You just shared this email address with everyone out there.
I don't use it for anything. This is...
So don't send Joe feedback on that email.
Yeah, that's not my real email address. All it is for this demo. If you send it there, I guess you could send it here right now and something would pop up. Don't do that.
Don't do that. No.
But we don't check this email alias, so it's not going to be very useful to you to send emails to. So it is running right now. There we go. Completed. And you can see in the output, it's saying the current date and time. It's saying, it looks like the output got jumbled a bit there, but it's saying the users, it's saying it's going to notify users about this VM, and then removing VMs, there's nothing under that because it's not going to actually notify based on them. So what this has done behind the scenes is go and send me an email. So if I come in here, I hit inbox. Oh no, is it? So email can sometimes take a little while to come. So I might have to come back to this later. But I can show you the message that came in last time.
Oh, if you want, I actually got another question here. Now, since you're kind of talking about the different outputs, and a little earlier you talked about verbose login, this is kind of a specific question, but apparently when you do verbose login output, you get the full GUID with every message. Is there a way to go and change the filter so that you get the server name instead of like a GUID?
There's not right now. That's kind of a limitation on PowerShell where the verbose says the ID. What you could do is in your verbose message, actually put the computer name as part of the message, and then when you go and search, type the computer name, and it'll filter it to only show messages that have the computer name in it. PowerShell is also thinking for the future on how to make their logging more like the event log, where you have kind of more strongly typed logging, where you have categories and you have tags and all that stuff. For now, you basically have to take matters into your own hands and within the message actually go and say something.
Great. Well, that should still help them out. That should still get
them. Yeah, should unblock it. All right, let's see if that email came. If not, I'm going to be very sad. Well, let's see if that email sent. So here's another inbox that's supposed to send the email. So the time is 10:13. You can see at 10:11 it sent a new email to joe123@outlook.com. So it did correctly send the email. It's just because of how email works, it's not coming through yet.
Just taking a moment. Well, while we're still waiting for that, actually another good question came up around further integration, but this time with other integration systems. Could we, for example, we talked about Orchestrator already, but could we, for example, be able to integrate with TFS? Could we go integrate with Chef and Puppet? Could we go integrate with any of these other, you know, kind of centralized ticketing management automation systems as well?
Definitely. I mean, yes to all. But TFS we actually have done. We have examples that have been put out. We have a really great MVP named Ryan Andorfer has put out a whole solution on how to apply change control to your runbooks using TFS. And the way he does it is he uses the TFS mod. I think there's a PowerShell module that he uses for TFS. He imports it into the system, and he actually monitors a code repository for checked-in new runbooks. And whenever they're checked into there, he goes and he publishes them into SMA using a runbook in SMA. And he similarly has multiple SMA systems, one for like QA, one for dev, one for staging and production. And he has different branches on his repository to actually go and switch between. If I want to commit a runbook to production, I just merge my, you know, staging branch with my production one, and the runbook that is going monitoring these branches will actually push that runbook that's now been committed to my production branch into production.
Great. Thanks for clarifying.
So that's TFS. Chef and Puppet, I don't think we have examples for it today. DSC you can definitely do. Chef and Puppet should work too. I don't know what their kind of PowerShell support is, but if they have APIs, you can probably extend into them. So it doesn't look like our email is going to come, so I'll just go into this and show you our last email. You can see I said your VM is going to expire in 6 days. I said you need to request an extension if needed. One thing I like to do is this email address that actually sent the email is actually called Automation, so I gave Automation a name here. Too bad our email doesn't come through, but we did see on the other email account that it did send the email. It's just emails asynchronous. Sometimes it takes a little while to come.
We'll blame it on the cloud.
Blame it on the cloud. Not the Windows Azure Pack cloud, though.
Different one.
Okay, so that is my, I'll go back to my deck. That is my showing compliance demo. Basically, I've showed you allow self-service. People can go and do what they want, but then still applying some IT policy afterwards to go and kind of follow those rules to, in this case, clean up resources that we have rules on should be cleaned up after a certain amount of days. Actually, there's a little more of this demo that I want to go into. So if we can go back to the deck, I just remembered this. This will be good to cover. So what I had to do for this was actually start this manually. Now, you don't want to do that. You want this every day to go and check, are there VMs that are so old I should notify or remove? So what you can do is actually, this is the one asset we haven't talked about yet, is schedules. I can go and actually create a schedule. I'll call it Joe Daily. And then what I can do is I can set up a schedule either for one time in the future or for daily in the future. And I can say, you know, go from now until infinity every day, go and do this. And I want you to call this runbook. And, you know, here's where I would type in, again, maybe the same parameters. You wouldn't use zero in production. This is just for my testing. And test cloud, that was it. Test cloud. And I would go, and this is going to create a schedule now, actually run this runbook on the schedule. Every day it'll create a new job with these parameters to go and do this. So now I don't even have to go into here and start this process. The process will run for me on a set schedule. One more time, let's check that inbox. Nothing. Okay. We're going to go straight to the next demo then. All right. So I'll go back to my deck real quick.
Now, while you're switching over here, another question came up. Let me just grab that. So a lot of people have said, hey, this is really great examples that you've given us. Is there a place where they can get your samples from? Or do you have any other recommendations where they can get, you know, just getting started type of samples?
Mm-hmm. So we ship a ton of actually samples on integrating into different systems out of the box in SMA. There's actually around 20 runbooks for different systems.
Like built into the...
Built in.
Okay.
They're in there the first time you go into the portal. If you have the portal, if you're using the commandlets, they're in there through the web service. For things like integrating into VMM, Orchestrator, things like using parameters or using assets. So not just integrating into other systems, but also integrating using the different pieces of functionality, whether it's checkpoints, runbooks calling runbooks, runbooks using parameters. We have all the stuff that ships out of the box in SMA for you to use. In addition, we put out a lot of blogs. We have an Orchestrator blog.
We'll post a link to that right now.
We'll post a link to the Orchestrator blog. And we have a lot of, as part of those blogs, and in general, a lot of content that we put on Script Center that kind of is related to those blogs on how to do different things. So on Script Center, there's an, under System Center, there's an Orchestrator category or an SMA category, I'm not totally sure. And you click into that and it'll show you all this kind of content that we've put out, whether it's runbooks, modules, tools that help you with other things related to SMA that you can go and use to kind of learn more or get started doing some of these things. In terms of the demos from this talk, I don't think they're up there on Script Center yet, but probably go and post them because it sounds like it would be helpful. All right, so we go back to our deck. I just talked about enforcing compliance, of course. Next thing I want to talk about is differentiating your cloud offerings. So if you are a enterprise that acts as a hoster, or if you're a hoster in general, you're competing with other hosters, and you want people to use you. Whether it's internal users using you just because you want them to go through your system, which applies policy, versus using, you know, whatever other tools that on the public internet or something, or as a regular hoster where you're trying to get users to use you because you want to make money. So the way to do that is to differentiate from other hosters and make your system better. And so the way you do that is by differentiating. And so if we go back to the deck, in terms of compliance, I just showed one compliance example. Another example of a compliance action you could do is actually every time... So VM Clouds, and I'll show this in a sec, VM Clouds has an extension where you can say anytime an action happens in WAP, go and start this runbook. So you can use that for compliance to say every time a create VM action happens in WAP, I have a policy in my organization that says all VMs in certain clouds need to be monitored. So I would go and on that VM that's getting created, automatically go and add integrated monitoring. I didn't show that demo, but I'm about to show essentially the same thing. But it's kind of from a different standpoint. It's not compliance, it's from differentiating your services. So that would be aimed at compliance, but the same exact thing happens if we go back to the deck, actually. So we have enforcing compliance and differentiating services are actually essentially, this process is exactly the same. But for compliance, you're doing it for your internal organization members, and for differentiating services, instead of saying, hey, this is a policy we have to apply on your VMs, you're saying, hey, this is something great you get if you sign up for our, you know, maybe a little bit more expensive managed cloud plan. In addition, when you create a VM, we'll go and automatically add managed monitoring to it. So you can see the steps are the same. They provision the VM. We wait for the VM creation to get completed. VM Clouds has kicked off a runbook to do something, and then we actually go and install the OM agent, and we just start monitoring it for you. And maybe we have other runbooks that go and check OM, and if we see some, you know, bad state for your VM, we either automatically take remediation actions or we alert you if the remediation actions don't work, you know, things like that. So now what I'll show is a demo of essentially hooking up this in the hoster mindset where you're doing it to try to add more services to your cloud.
All right, well, while you switch over here, I'll share the results of the poll here. And the question was about how do you centrally manage your IT automation? It turns out about 40% of our audience has no centralized management. They just got random scripts running on random servers. So hopefully they're going to take these best practices that we're building here, go ahead and deploy that. We have about 20% using scripts that are in a centralized share that people go and invoke. About 15% are using Orchestrator. 12% are using some other third-party automation solution, And very few are using TFS, and there's a bunch of people that are using others. So kind of diverse. I think the biggest surprise here is that 40% are using no centralized management solution.
Right.
So they will be soon, right?
Hopefully you love SMA. One thing I'd like to note, actually, is we actually now have a service on Azure called Azure Automation, which makes it super easy to go and play around with SMA without having to do any install work at all. It's basically SMA delivered as a service. It might not work for if you need to do on-premise management, but in terms of playing around with the different features and functionality, you can go use it, sign up real quick, and just basically get the same exact interface to go and play around in. So it's a great way to eval without having to really install anything. And then once you, and I know you will, decide you like Azure Automation, Service Management Automation, you can go and do the work to actually set it up in production and install it in your on-premise environment.
Now if somebody did have a hybrid connection, you know, like a site-to-site VPN, could they use the Azure-based automation to actually go and invoke things locally?
So we do have somewhat of a story for that. Azure Automation is even newer than Service Management Automation. It basically is in preview, came out a couple months ago. Right now, what you can do if you want to talk to on-prem from Azure Automation is you actually have a VM set up that's part of a VPN that can talk on-prem. And from Azure Automation, you talk to that VM, and from that VM, you talk to on-prem. So right now, it's not the best story that you could have. We're working to improve that. It's a preview service that just came out, so it's kind of something.
Stay tuned, right.
Stay tuned, exactly. Maybe I'll be on here in the future talking about that, maybe. Okay, so back at our demo. So I'm sure you've heard a lot about VM clouds already. What you may not have heard about is this automation tab within here. And what this lets you do is actually, using the SMA web service behind the scenes, it allows you to configure VM clouds, SPF, to go and actually call a runbook in service management automation based on a certain action. So if I click add, you can see I have all these actions in here I can do. I want to do actually when you create a virtual machine, if you're on the managed services plan, I'm going to go and actually add integrated monitoring straight into your VM for you as kind of a value add, a differentiating my services action. So I picked virtual machine as my object action. I already have a create, which is why it's not appearing here. But create would be here if I didn't have it already created. And then I can pick a runbook. The way you set up runbooks to be able to show up here is you tag them with SPF. So these are the two runbooks I have tagged in SMA with SPF. So they're showing up. But you can see for create virtual machine, I already have this hooked up for my add managed services runbook. So if I click into service management automation, click into my runbooks, and find add managed services, you can see it's right here. Essentially what this does, if I go into drafts, you can see it a bit better. So this is called by SPF, and it's passed in a bunch of parameters by SPF. And I'll show you what the values are for those in a second. But essentially what it goes and does is, again, you can see I'm using automation assets. I'm grabbing a variable for my SPF URL. I'm grabbing a credential for how to connect into SPF, like who has access. And then I'm saying for anyone on the gold plan, so I have a plan in here. I have a basic plan. I have a gold plan. And I'm saying, okay, if you sign up for the gold plan, maybe it costs a little bit more. But what you're going to get is not just these same services as basic, but you also get this. We'll automatically add these managed services like managed monitoring. So for the gold plan, I'm actually going to go and I do this loop until the VM has finished being created. And once the VM has finished being created, I actually, using the data given to me by SPF, I figure out what the cloud that it's being placed on is. And if that cloud is basically the right plan that I should be adding managed services, then I call the sub-runbook install OM agent. Sorry, it looks like it's jumping around a little because I'm zoomed in a bit. It calls install OM agent, which is another runbook in here. So I'll show you that. If I click into install OM agent, you can see it takes in a computer name on what to install the OM agent on. And then it actually goes, again, using a connection to talk to operations manager. It remotes the operations manager computer, and it basically sets up SCOM to install an agent on that computer. It also configures the firewall up here so that SCOM is able to kind of reach out to our central SCOM server from the agent.
Now, just to confirm, would you need administrative access to be able to do this to the VM? And I guess really the question is if the tenant wants privacy and they don't want the host to access in the VM, can they block people from installing this?
It's a good question, and yes, you can definitely do that based on the networks that your VM is configured to be on. If it's not exposed directly to the administrative network, the administrator won't be able to, from SMA, which is on the administrative network, be able to see that VM at all. It kind of depends what you want to do and how you want to set up privacy versus the ability to automatically manage these systems. Privacy could be another add-on service, and maybe you wouldn't be able to do managed OM for them automatically, but you would offer them the privacy plan. So now what I'll go and do is actually start a runbook. Sorry, I will create a VM, which will end up starting a runbook using that VM action that is configured in VM clouds. So this tenant, in addition to being on test cloud, now let's pretend he's a tenant of a hoster, and he signed up for the gold plan. So he expects any VM that he creates in the gold plan to actually have integrated monitoring on it, managed monitoring, because that was one of the things he was told he'd get with the gold plan. So let's actually create a virtual machine. And you can see for subscription, I'm going to pick gold because I'm only going to do this integrated monitoring on gold. And I can name this whatever I want. And password doesn't much matter since for this. And then I will hit go and actually create the VM. So the VM is being created now. That obviously will take a while. So what happens immediately is that runbook gets kicked off. So if I go back to my add managed services runbook, which is the one I hooked up to be kicked off on a create VM action, and I go to jobs, you'll see that a job has now been created based on that action being taken by a tenant. See, so you can see this job is happening. And if I click into that, you can see all the data that was passed in, which is a lot of data. Virtual machine, create, and then a bunch of params to the operation, a bunch of information about the resource. So it's not very human readable, but this all comes in as objects to the runbook. And then the runbook can basically pick properties of that object to do different things. And then, so it's going to take a while to actually run because it has to go and provision the VM. And then after the VM is provisioned, you add the managed monitoring. So what I'm going to do is do the cooking show way of doing things and actually fast forward or go to a previous execution of this to show you what it does at the end. So you can see this add managed service, which I ran yesterday, it looks like completed. And you can see here's all the output. It's spitting out the progress on creating the VM. And then you'll see at the end, it actually checks if the VM is in the gold plan. It sees that it is in the gold plan. And so it goes and actually adds those managed services. So it disables the firewall enough so that OM can reach out to our centralized OM server. And it actually installs the operations management agent on that VM. So now, in addition to offering basic cloud services, you can also have kind of tiered plans that do more things to differentiate your services from other hosters. And that concludes this demo.
All right. Well, as we switch back, we did have another question about mm-hmm. having this be used as a distributed system. Is there a maximum on the number of hosts that you can go and trigger workflows on, or a maximum number of hosts where you can go spin off worker threads on?
There's not a maximum. You will rarely need, I think our recommended number is 3 workers with like 4 gigabytes each. You'll rarely need to scale too much. If you're doing a ton and a ton of automation, which would be great if you are, then you may need to scale up more. But we don't have a maximum. I mean, you add more, you configure them to be in the deployment to actually go and check the database for new jobs. And as many as you need should work.
Great.
So that was my differentiating cloud offerings demo. And if we go back to the deck, so one last thing I wanted to cover is just the fact that I covered a very small amount of what you can do in service management automation. Enforcing compliance while enabling IT policy, differentiating your services, integrating in for specific scenario, in this case managing Linux. But you can do whatever you want in here. I mean, it's an extensible platform for automating processes. So any processes that are long-running, manual, error-prone, repeated, any combination of those words, they're a great thing to automate because it frees up your time to, instead of doing these things, which are kind of repeated tasks or error-prone tasks, have the automation engine execute them reliably the exact same way every time. And then you can go and actually spend your time doing more value add things than just kind of doing the same important but kind of menial tasks every day. And then if we go to the review, and just go over what I talked about. Service management automation is great for automating your processes that you continue to do in your Windows Azure Pack environment. It's great to integrate into your existing data center operations or to other non-Windows Azure Pack systems. It makes it very easy to enforce compliance while enabling self-service, and it allows you to differentiate your cloud offerings if you operate in a hoster type environment where you want to be different from everyone else that's out there, and you want to create custom processes to do different things.
So one last question is kind of a bit of a scenario-based question, but we want to kind of explore some of the capabilities of SMA. So the question is here, could SMA be used to extract usage information from one system and then pass that to a different billing system so that you can then go and provide chargeback? So take information from one system, process it, go spit it out to a different system.
So Windows Azure Pack has this usage endpoint, and you can... That will collect all the uses information for you for Windows Azure Pack. In terms of its API integration, I know it has an API. I can't tell you whether there's a PowerShell module today for it. But if it has an API, you can create one for it. And then the external system part, whether it's a CMDB or another usage database, you can definitely, from a runbook, I mean, that's a great use case for a runbook, collect the data from the usage endpoint for Windows Azure Pack and then plug it into this other usage endpoint that you're using for your kind of larger enterprise or hosting scenarios for things more than just the Windows Azure Pack. You can definitely go and do that with a runbook.
Awesome. Well, thanks so much for coming on. I just want to remind people of the final few resources that we have available, including the Microsoft Virtual Academy, TechNet Virtual Labs, and of course the Orchestrator Team blog, which is going to be a great place for people to get started with SMA.
Right.
Well, Joe, thanks so much for joining me on the show. If you have any other questions, please continue to put them in the chat. We'll continue answering them. And now we're going to take a 10-minute break. We'll be back after that talking about some of our third-party extensibility through the Windows Azure Pack. See you soon.